This is the Avaya Podcast Network, APN. Technology, news, and information. All in one place.
This is the E911 Talk Podcast, episode 97, for Thursday, August 9th, 2012.
Welcome to this edition of E911 Talk with your host, Mark Fletcher, Pilot Line Manager for Emergency Services at Avaya. Now, here's Fletch.
In short, the question is no longer can they, but shall they, and by when? These words concluded the opening paragraph of the reply comments by the National Emergency Number Association, or NENA, to the Federal Communications Commission in response to their public notice as part of the Middle Class Tax Relief and Job Creation Act of 2012, which was signed into law earlier this year by the President. Initial responses to the Notice of Inquiry were received by the Federal Communications Commission on July 6th of 2012 and were filed by APCO, AT&T, Avaya, Intrado, NENA, Telecommunications Industry Association, the Texas 911 Alliance, Administrative Council for Technical Attachments, Verizon, Verizon Wireless, and the Voice on the Net Coalition. Reply comments were due this past week, and NENA focused on five particular points in their comments. The primary highlights of these points are as follows. Number one, it is clearly feasible for manufacturers to include E911 location capabilities in MLTS. Now, based on the responses of the original notice of inquiry, it is, quote, unquestionably feasible for manufacturers of MLTS to include within those systems the capability to identify location of a 911 caller with sufficient precision to support an effective response, unquote. They also noted that comments by Verizon as well as the California Public Utilities Commission both supported this claim in their responses. Number two, if further standards work is required, only a mandatory deadline will ensure its completion. So although both NENA and Intrado both agree that existing standards will sufficiently allow MLTS to provide precise locations, others felt that additional work is needed. NENA's argument is that although additional standards would provide further guidance, without a mandatory deadline, it is questionable if those standards work would ever be completed. Number three, MLTS using circuit-switched PSTN interfaces cannot be excluded from forward-looking rules. Although next-generation 911 is foreseeable in the near future, NENA concedes that the legacy PSTN environment is going to continue to exist for, quote, decades to come, unquote. Now, based on the fact that technology exists today to support TDM-based MLTS 911 location capabilities, therefore, a waiver is not needed for legacy systems. They do include, however, a provision for potential burdensome network changes. And if that could be demonstrated, NENA would consider allowing providers to offer only IP-based provisioning tools after a specific date. By doing this, the forward-looking burden would be placed on the manufacturers and the operators of TDM-based MLTS. Number four, enforcement of Part 68 rules, if adopted, will be important to the success of MLTS E911 rules. As stated on the FCC website, Part 68 of the FCC rules cover the connection of terminal equipment to the public switch telephone network. Now, in addition to establishing technical specifications for the equipment, Part 68 also contains provisions to protect consumers as well as allowing them access to competitive services. For example, the rules for hearing aid compatibility and volume control for people with disabilities are covered under Part 68, as well as the technical criteria for things like inside wiring. So establishing MLTS E911 rules under Part 68 would finally provide the appropriate legal representation MLTS E911 desperately needs. Number five, dependency of an MLTS solution on actions by a user is secondary, if not irrelevant, to the feasibility of a mandate for manufacturers. This piece was just so well written that there's no way that I could do it any justice by paraphrasing it. So I'll just include it in its entirety so you can enjoy its real tone. Several commenters noticed that successful implementation of MLTS E911 location capabilities on an individual installation basis is contingent on more than the underlying capabilities of the MLTS system in question. It is certainly true that MLTS owners and operators must properly install and maintain those systems to ensure that their residents, students, employees, or enlistees can be located in an emergency. But it is wrong to suggest that because some will fail in this duty, many should be denied the opportunity to succeed in it. Without an MLTS location mandate, well-intentioned purchasers of such systems may fall victim to unknown and undisclosed E911 limitations. Worse, some may succumb to the perverse incentive of systems that appear cheaper because they conceal the costs of litigation and damages that may be occasioned when a user cannot be located in an emergency. Similarly, the absence of a mandate provides a competitive advantage to manufacturers of MLTS that do not support E911 location capabilities, and that therefore cost less than those which do. None of these scenarios is in the public interest. Imposition of an E911 location mandate for MLTS is. Conclusion: the Commission should ignore calls for eternal delay, report to Congress that MLTS location capabilities are feasible, and begin a proceeding to establish a time frame for mandatory implementation. Wow. Well done, Nina. Personally, I've been working on MLTS compliance for the past 12 years or so. With MLTS systems providing more mobility today than ever before, the need for accurate location granularity for users who need to call for emergency services is something that can no longer be ignored. The problem is not a difficult one to fix. The technology is readily available and it's affordable. Only 18 states have any legislation on the books today. Based on how long that's taken, I'm not sure we can wait for the other 32 to get on board.
You've been listening to the E911 Talk Podcast with your host, Mark Fletcher, product line manager for emergency services at Avaya. E911 Talk is a weekly podcast available on sites like this, as well as iTunes, and is available free of charge. If you have any comments or questions, you can email Fletch at FletcherM@Avaya.com. That's Fletcher, the letter M, at Avaya.com. Be sure to listen in next week for more informative topics on E911.
911, the line is recorded. What is the exact location of your emergency?
This is the Avaya Podcast Network, APN.